learners, welcome to this session. Today we will discuss module 2, that is functions and techniques of law. In this, the topic which we will discuss is normative functions of law and social control. You know, you must have seen in your society, in your family, that whenever we talk to any individual, then we follow certain rules and procedures. Whenever we get up also after bed, then you know we have certain rules and norms. We have to first go and brush our teeth, we have to get ready, then we have, after completing the normal course, we have to do certain other things like breakfast, etc. How do we have all these things? Have you ever thought about it? You know, when we are brought up in a family, then there are some family rules. So the rules which are there in the family, we are following that only. And this is called a norm or a set of rules and regulations which on daily basis we are following since our birth. And you know, sometimes you know it is said that law is something which is very different. You know, when we are born, we are not following any law, we don't know about law, but it is not true. As the baby comes in the womb of a mother, till that period when he or she is in the womb and after the birth of the baby, we follow certain norms and procedure. So that is normative function of law. And what is this social control? Social control, as I just discussed, is a control which is given by the society. So living in a society as a human being, we follow certain rules and regulations. As I said, after sleeping, when we get up in the morning, we have certain things to do. So we just do that in a normal course. We don't understand that these are the things which have been trained, you know. We have been trained to do and follow all these rules. So law is not something which is outside the society. Law is not something, you know, which we have to read and study and understand. Law is something which we practice on day-to-day basis. And similarly, this is normative functions of law. Norms, rules or standard maintain discipline in the society. So when we are in the house, then we have to follow certain rules. And those rules are as per our family mandates. So we have to maintain discipline in the society. When we are in the family, we have to follow some rules. When we go out from the house, then we also follow some rules. When we are in the classroom, even when we are playing, you know, we have some game rules. So on every front of life, we follow certain rules and traditions, and those are the norms. So whenever I go and start my play, I have to be playing as if I have a big team, and this is a teamwork. I cannot fight with people. I cannot say that only I will bowl or only I will bat. So everybody gets an equal opportunity or a chance, and then everybody enjoys that game. Similarly, in the classroom, you know, you have to maintain discipline. If the teacher is talking and we as children start speaking so much, then how will the teacher teach us? Or vice versa. Suppose, you know, 4 or 5 teachers come together. All of a sudden, they start speaking. Then how will the child understand? Somebody is teaching you history simultaneously. Second teacher is teaching you science. Then the other is teaching you maths and the other is teaching you English. So how will you understand? On which subject will you concentrate? So the classroom teaching has to be such that a subject has to be focused on, and then on the subject also you have to take a particular topic, and in that topic you will discuss certain things. So then, you know, the classroom teaching is very effective, because in the classroom teaching the teacher will ask you certain questions. So she will clear all your doubts. Similarly, we have self-learning materials wherein, you know, we have self-help exercises wherein you have self-check exercises. Once you read a paragraph, then there are certain questions. So you can check your answers and see whether you have understood or not. So these norms are very much there in the family, in the society, and we follow them on day-to-day basis. Then, you know, we will talk about the objectives of this. So what the first objective will be, we have to understand what are the norms. Then we have to differentiate between legal norms and other norms. Then role of norms in maintaining social order is also very important to understand. Then role of law in social control. Then we will define alternative dispute resolution, ADR. And this is a very important aspect, you know, to bring legal education to the people, to, you know, talk about when we have small petty differences or litigations which we want to solve. So we will also discuss ADR in this. Then what are the various forms of ADR? We will also talk about them. Then role of Lok Adalats in resolving disputes, role of Supreme Court in bringing socio-economic changes in the society, and that is very important. How has social, you know, social and economic changes have come up in the society? Because, you know, we are not a static society. We are a developing country, and every time we have certain norms and procedures which change by the need of the time, and they are also reflecting in the legal legislations. So when we follow certain rules and standards, then the Supreme Court by its judgments also have certain interpretation of laws. So while the Supreme Court or the other courts interpret the law, then that law becomes, the society needs that law, and that leads to a change in the existing norm. So Supreme Court decisions will also be discussed. When we talk about the norm, social norms are the beliefs of the society. When I talk about beliefs, you know, it is that how should I behave with the other person. Norm signifies a standard or behavior to be followed by the society. I just discussed that religion, ethical standards, custom and usages of law are, you know, various modes wherein we have been given certain norms or certain rules to be followed. Our religion talks about certain rules to be followed. Our ethical standards also talks about certain rules to be followed. Our customs, our traditions, you know, the marriage, divorce laws, the adoption laws, all these are based on certain customs which we follow. Then usages are also very important when we talk about a norm in the society. All societies impose social control on their citizen by laws, code and police. But you know, sometimes what we feel in our country, that moral obligations, moral duties, the directive principles of state policy play a vital role in becoming a good citizen. I do not follow law because I am afraid of some police officer coming to me if I break the law. I follow the law because I know that if I follow the law, then my rights will be also respected, because it is the same sense, rights and duties go together. So if I do not do my obligations, if I do not fulfill my rights and duties together, then I do not expect the same from the other person. So we have tradition-bound societies, you know, which generally and slowly change. And we have multi-ethnic societies where norm changes rapidly. When I talk about a tradition-bound society, I want to discuss here that when we talk about any religion norm, then you know we practice it over decades. I got this tradition from my mother-in-law. My mother-in-law must have got this tradition from her mother-in-law or from her mother. So this continues from generation to generation. But in multi-ethnic society, the norm changes rapidly. So it is not that in one day basis the norms will change, not definitely, but it will change at a greater pace as compared to the tradition-bound society, wherein we are so inbuilt in our traditions that we don't want to change. And many a times norm changes at a faster pace than the law. This is very true, you know. What are norms? Maybe the rules of a house. So maybe today four people are staying in the house, and then they decide that this existing norm or this existing rule or procedure should be changed. We always sit together and eat our food. The timings can change, the procedure can change, the menu can change. So, you know, in a family, a norm can change at a later space, a much faster space, wherein the law which has come up will change in due course only, because the law can only change with the act of the parliament. So the legislature has to change the law, the legislature has to amend the law, or the legislature has to repeal the law. But as a society, I can change my norm. If majority of society people decide that okay, this will be the society norms, then everybody will start following that norm. But a law will take its own pace to change. Then realization of acceptance of the moral codes are very important. You know, I just discussed that we don't follow law because we have a fear of some police officer. I don't do my duties as a mother, as a teacher, because I know that somebody here is checking me out, and if I do not do my duty, then I will be punished. So punishment factor or the deterrent factor is not that effective as a moral code factor, wherein, you know, I have my legal duties, I have my moral duties, and day-to-day basis, you know, I do my duties because I want to lead a good life. I want to live a life which is as per the welfare state norms, wherein I have certain duties to fulfill, and on the other hand, I have certain rights to enjoy. So I will do my duties thinking that I am willing to do it as per my rules and traditions. I will do it morally. I am so strong. My, you know, family system is such that I am so strong morally that I will like to do, enjoy doing work than to have a compulsion of any kind. Laws and courts are there just to protect my rights. Laws and courts are there to interpret the rights. And laws and courts are there wherein if I have a problem, then I will go to the court of law and seek justice. Then, you know, role of norms is maintaining social order. Sometimes law has to intervene in moral social practices prevalent to the society to curb evil social practices, and this happened in India. You know, we have dowry prohibition law, we have Untouchability Act, and then we have Sati Act. So all these laws were there. So we had a norm, we had a tradition, we had a custom which was broken by these legislations in the ground that this was very important for having a social justice in the society. If we want to develop and if we want to protect our dignity and worth, then it is very important that these kinds of legislations are implemented in true sense in India. Because, you know, dowry prohibition is something which is very important. How can you sell a person? How can you buy a person? How can you say that that person is not allowed to enter my village? How can you say that this person cannot walk on my street or cannot take water from the same well, cannot study in the school? So we have a social system. We all follow the social system and the social order. But that has to have certain justifications. We all are equal in the eyes of law. So when we have this constitutional right, wherein we all are equal in the eyes of law, how can we discriminate a person on the basis of caste, creed, language, or any other thing? So we have a fundamental right wherein you cannot discriminate a person on these bases. So we have certain rules, we have certain norms. If those norms are not protecting the rights of the citizens of the country, then the legislature can come up and have certain laws to eradicate these social practices, and wherein we have all accepted it. You know, we are a developing society, so we do not resist anything which comes up for the good of the country. Anything which comes up for the development of the country is appreciated by the country members. Even we see land laws, wherein you say that concentration of wealth in few hands is not done. So that is also for the development of the country only. Then, as I discussed, that social economic goal of the constitution is very important, you know. Legislative reforms of land laws also came, because you know you cannot concentrate a particular piece of land in the hands of few, and you cannot say that these people will work as laborers or as bonded laborers in these fields without any rights. Or maybe in the end of the day, you give them a piece of meal for their family members. So we have Minimum Wages Act. We have labor laws, wherein you know your working hours are decided, because we are a socialist pattern country. So we have working hours, we have Minimum Wages Act, we have certain dignity of work. So you cannot employ me in hazardous employment. Then you have to ensure my dignity and worth at the workplace. You cannot give me work for 20 hours, you know. I have to work as per my development. You cannot force me that I work in your field or in your factory or in your organization for long hours. So I, as an employer, cannot force the employee to work in strained relationships. Then we have maternity legislations, wherein the women employees are given certain benefits. It can be in the form of childcare leave. It can be in the form of child rearing period leave. So that is all for the benefit of the society, because a child is the future of the country. So if you are giving a mother a time to rear the child in a good atmosphere, then that will contribute to the nation. Then we have family laws. How do I marry somebody? If I want to be separated, how can I separate from the marriage tie? Then what will be the rules and procedures of adoption, of succession, and how will you know I get maintenance from my family? So these rules are decided in family law. And we have certain laws in India wherein we talk about these legislations which are implemented for our betterment. So we have Muslim laws, we have Hindu laws. In Muslim laws also we have a lot of things, you know, wherein we have maintenance laws, we have adoption laws, and we have marriage and divorce laws. Then removal of social evils and disabilities, you know, when we talk about all are equal, how will we ensure equality of these five fingers in my hand? Are they the same? Are they the same means at the same height, at the same potential? They can be called the same thing? No, because we have a society wherein we have different religions, we have different languages, we have different caste system. The water changes after a period. Even the landform is different, you know. I may be having a very fertile land, and a person staying in some other part of India may be in a desert area. So when we are so different in our habits, in our learning, in our understanding, in our opportunities, I cannot compare somebody sitting in Delhi with somebody sitting in a remote village where you don't get electricity for 24 hours. So can you say that we all are equal? No, we are not equal. So we have certain special legislations for people who are not equal. And therein comes disability rights. Any kind of disability, you know. I may be having any kind of disability. And if you do not provide me equal opportunity platform, then the state is not a welfare state. So disability is not for me. Disability is for the state, that you don't give me equal opportunity to grow. You don't give me equal opportunity to study. So this is where the norm comes and the role of law comes. You have to make legislations, you have to implement those legislations properly, and you have to see that if the legislations are not implemented properly and somebody's or someone's right has been abridged, then that person should get speedy justice. Because justice should be speedy, justice should be timely, justice should be as per the case. So, persons with different abilities also have different legislations in India, wherein, you know, we bring them on equal platform with all people, and therein we can say that the fundamental rights are implemented in India in the real sense. We are talking equal opportunities in education. We have educational institutions which do not differentiate between a disabled candidate and other candidate. We cannot say that the educational material will only be provided for the people who can read and write. It has to be provided to people also who cannot read and write, because education is my right. Article 21A talks about right to education. So, education is my right. So, how can you deprive me of this right to education? So, if I provide you a platform wherein it is very easily to commute, I have a good commutation system as a government, I have a good braille system wherein the blind students can study, I have a different technology factor wherein, you know, the technology is used to abridge the gaps. So, wherein I use technology and I give you certain opportunities so that as a state I fulfill my duties and I treat you equal. I think about your rights also, then this is the rule of law. Then Supreme Court has also given some very important legislations for socio-economic changes. And this is a very important, you know, because socially we are very different from each other, economically we are very different from each other. But, you know, can we say that Article 21 is implemented for A group, but Article 21 is not implemented for B group? Or can we say that right to equality is for me, but it is not for you? Or can I say that dignity and worth can have a different meaning or connotation for X as compared to Y? When I go to the court of law, I will be treated at par as if you go to the court of law. So, Supreme Court has given very good judgments, where even, you know, Navjot Singh case, wherein, you know, you have certain rights. Because you are a human being, you cannot be deprived of having these rights. And your rights are ensured by the Constitution of India. Interpretation of the Constitution in a positive way. You know, the Supreme Court has interpreted the Constitution so well. You know, we have right to free legal aid. I cannot afford a lawyer, but I can go to the court of law and defend my case if my human rights are violated, if my legal rights are violated. If public interest litigation is there, you know, what is this public interest litigation? For a common cause, any like-minded person can go to the court of law and say that this is a common cause. This is a matter of general importance, and the court will take up the matter and will interpret it in giving justice to the majority of people. Interpretation of welfare legislation is also very important. You know, because the Supreme Court and the other courts have interpreted the legislations in a proper way. Then we talk about alternative dispute resolution. This is the best platform, you know. When I talk about that, the justice should come to you at a greater space and in a short period of time you should get justice, then dispute resolution process techniques act as means for disagreeing parties to come to an agreement, which is short of litigation. You know, we should have valid arbitration agreement between the parties before the dispute arises. The process of appointing an arbitrator is mentioned there. If, you know, by the parties the arbitrator is not appointed, then I as a party can take the help of Chief Justice for appointment of the arbitrator. Then we have arbitration tribunal and appeal also. And in conciliation, you know, prior agreement is not required, but in arbitration you have to have a written agreement. Conciliator is appointed to settle the dispute, and terms of settlement mentioned in the settlement dispute also are respected by the parties. Then the very important factor is the Lok Adalat factor. You know, it is called People's Court. We have from, you know, we have from ancient India wherein, you know, you could ring a bell and talk about this Lok Adalat system. We have a system wherein the district state authority, the legal services state authority come up and have periodical Lok Adalats, wherein, you know, you take up the cases of the common people of a particular area. And the advantage of this Lok Adalat system is such that it talks about the local problems. So we have retired judges, we have social activists, we have members of legal profession who come, and you know, the proceedings of the Lok Adalat are deemed to be judicial proceedings, and it is also considered as a civil court. And the purpose of Lok Adalat is to come to a conclusion, wherein the parties come to a conclusion and they settle. So community based ADR or Nyay Panchayats are a very good platform, you know, because then you can take up your case, you have your local issues, your local problems, your local people representing you, and they can address your issues, your problems in a much better way. So this is how the ADR functions in India, wherein you have awards and you respect those awards, and then you understand your problems, you can solve your case or your problems by mutual settlements in a proper way and a timely way. Thank you for this session.